This week on CrossFeed,
a French recipe for a new denomination.
Keeping cookies kosher.
Mormons. Black, liberal, Democrat.
New York City. Churches cannot meet schools, but schools can meet in churches.
And is the story of Jesus just a warmed-over pagan myth?
Hello, everyone, and welcome to CrossFeed Religious News. I'm Pastor Dale Critchley, pastor of Shepherd of the Ridge Lutheran Church in North Ridgeville, Ohio.
I'm Pastor Jim Butler of St. Luke's Lutheran Church out in beautiful Dedham, Massachusetts. It's good to be here this week. We were gone last week. Dale had something going on. But now he is the proud father of a high school graduate, and he's about ready to go deep into debt the rest of his life to pay for college. So.
Yeah, well, thankfully she's a good student, so she's gotten a boatload of scholarships. That'll help a lot. So
yeah, so I congratulate you and congratulate your daughter. It's a good accomplishment.
Yep. Yeah, so. I'm really proud of her. Crazy proud of her.
So good.
So although it's going to be rough. I'm going to lose her in my worship band at church. So
God will bring up someone else.
Yeah, well, he already has brought up one, so.
See, it works. It works. And yesterday was our Feed the Need 5K. We did a 5K walk run for the local food pantry. We had about 70 walkers and runners, so we were very happy with it. We're hoping for over 100 next year. So we're already decided there's like three or four things we've got to change next year. We need to get this thing going, and let's go ahead and get started. Oh, my goodness. Where should we begin? Well, interestingly enough, the organization I work with to do the food fundraiser is called Feed the Need, and it's kind of run by a bunch of Mormons, but they are unusual Mormons because they're white, conservative, and Republican. That's supposed to be the kind of Mormons are supposed to be out there. But there are, interestingly enough, other Mormons.
So this is from the New York Times. And it's talking about a number of Mormons who there's a growing black population in the Mormon church. You didn't used to see that because, well, they believe that black skin is a curse. That is their official teaching. They've changed it somewhat because... the Mormon God can change his mind. But, and I've never really understood how they got around that. But anyway, basically what it comes down to is because statistically, most African-American people are Democrats, and so are many of these who have become Mormons. And so they find themselves in a bit of a quandary. He was saying, well, okay, on the one hand, I'm black, and so I'm really happy that that there's a black president that I feel represents me. Okay? But then on the other hand, they say, I'm Mormon, and with Mitt Romney being the Republican candidate, who do I vote for?
I guess one is she's a professor at Brigham State University, I guess. Just as a professor here, doesn't say where she's a professor, if it's University of Utah or BYU. But her name is Marguerite Dreesen, and she became a Mormon as an adult. And it says, a Mormon candidate and a black candidate. Who would have thunk?
Yeah.
You're absolutely right.
Yeah, no, absolutely. That's great. Here's the thing. The thing that struck me the most in this article that sort of saddened and frustrated me was, and maybe it's just because I don't understand because I've never been in a persecuted population group, but this whole idea of voting for Barack Obama, I mean, here, the religion is very much a part of me, but I was born black and I will die black.
Fran? No, thank you. I take it black. Like my man.
And I just, wait a minute. So? You know, wasn't the whole point of Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech is that people are not judged by the color of their skin? Is that only in the negative? And that's just really, it just seems like they're, you know, I sort of wonder, I wish that Dr. King were still around to get his take on this. You know, I don't know. The whole thing kind of bothers me. I mean, I don't think that you should vote for someone based on their religion either. But at the same time, you know, if I were part of a religious minority like that and had a candidate that represented my values, and, you know, my beliefs, then yeah, you know, I'd probably, if there was a Missouri Synod candidate, I'd probably have to give some good long thinking to, whether I'd vote for them or, you know, regardless. A little solidarity.
Yeah, we had one of them, Paul Simon. Nope. Anyway, but I like this other black Mormon woman from Washington, D.C. I guess it's of Washington. It doesn't say Washington, D.C. or Washington State. With respect to Romney being a Mormon, bless his heart. I think he's a strange character. He got confused by money, I think. So he doesn't understand reality today. I'm not sure that a president who hangs around with everybody in Hollywood understands reality either. they've got that in common.
Yeah. You know, we have... here. My problem with Romney politically is he cannot relate to the common man. I'm afraid what would happen to the economy given his frame of reference. And President Obama can? I mean, like, have you seen the vacations that he takes and like, what his idea of date night is? Oh, we're gonna get in Air Force One and fly to Chicago for Valentine's Day. No, yeah, I'm sorry, but that's not relating to the common man. Now, he may be justifying that decision. I'm not gonna get into, you know, what it is to be the president and what expectations are and things like that, but that's not relating to the common man. All right, the reality is neither one of them can.
She's absolutely right. If Romney was elected, we might have unemployment over 8.2%, over 8%. It might stay there for, I don't know, 3 years. I might spend $1 trillion and, you know, not go down. Oh, wait a minute. I'm sorry. I forgot.
What it comes down to is that I do appreciate the people that say, you know, I just vote my conscience. And I really think that that's what you have to do. There's certainly going to be with any candidate, and we've said this before, with any candidate, there's going to be, things you agree with and things that you don't agree with.
Right.
I mean, I think that I have yet to find one that I agree with them on every single count. And you really have to look at, not only where do they agree and disagree with you on various issues, but how much of that is actually going to benefit the country in our current situation, whatever, you know, looking at all the various factors, you know, and keeping in mind they have to work with Congress and, you know, I mean, there's a lot of stuff to consider. And so, you know, I used to be pretty black and white when it came to issues and like I always said, I would never vote for a pro-choice candidate and things like that. But
you
know, at the
obviously
same,
never lived in Massachusetts.
Don't have a choice. but you know, I mean, at the same time, there are other factors, and a lot of times that can be a pretty narrow-minded idea that to be a sort of one-issue voter, and because. It, you know, a candidate may have a very strong stand on one particular issue, but if they're never going to be able to get Congress to act on that, then that ends up being a little peripheral thing that is
and
completely
not only
meaningless.
That, but it's easy to be. Well, okay, let me just give you a good example. Dick Gephardt used to be congressman from St. Louis, mm-hmm. and I remember. When I was in seminary and I was not registered to vote, I was going to opt out of the election. I didn't want to have to, you know, register in Missouri because I didn't really live there. I didn't want to do absentee in Kansas. So, but these guys at seminary saying, we've got to, you know, let's vote for Dick Gephardt. He's pro-life. He's, you know, And I refused to vote. I said, nope. And when the Supreme Court then made some allowances on restricting abortion, he suddenly turned around and became pro-choice. Well, it was very easy for him to be pro-life as long as he never had to vote on it. As long as anything he voted on, he knew had no chance. But now that, you know, that's no longer the case, he suddenly flipped.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, to my mind, that was his true heart. That's where his heart always was. But he could, you know, put up the line because he knew anything he voted would get struck down by the courts.
Sure. Well, and that's like President Obama with gay marriage. You know, I remember in his campaigns, he said he was against it. And yet at the same time, he supported the repeal of Proposition 8 in California. Well, which is he talking out of both sides of your mouth? Well, it was pretty clear, you know, where he really was. But, you know, and it's that cop out that politicians use. Well, this is what I believe is right, but I don't believe that I can impose my beliefs on others.
Well, in his case, by the way, he was for gay marriage before he was against it. Mm-hmm. When President Obama ran for state senator in Illinois, he was in favor of gay marriage. When he ran for senator from Illinois and had to now appeal to the entire state, he was against gay marriage. And then when he ran for president, was against. So it's just now that he's at the end of his career, it really doesn't make any difference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know?
And then you find out, you know, where people really stand.
So the Black Mormons say they've got an issue there to solve. But it's interesting, by the way, God, because there's like another woman, Black Mormon woman, from running for Congress from Utah, who said she's very conservative, former mayor, former raised several kids, and gun owner, and you know, Mormon all the way. So. It's interesting that it is an issue for some Black Mormons to figure things out. And it's going to be a problem for Jews going to Trader Joe's.
Yeah.
Okay. So here's the deal. If you ever look at a lot of your food that you get, you'll notice it's got a little K with a circle on it. And that means it's parveh. It is a parveh. That means it is kosher.
It doesn't mean that they got it from the Circle K down in the corner?
No. That it's kosher. And Trader Joe's has been selling kosher chocolate chips for some time. Thank you. My wife has to finish my sentences too. So now the rule is that, you know, you've got to keep things separate within a kosher house. Well, now because the manufacturer of the chocolate chips isn't going to wipe down the bagger before you put milk chocolate chips in a bag and stuff, and then they're going to run these chocolate chips through, but they're not going to wipe it down. So there might be some dairy residue left on the bagger. And because of that, it can no longer be considered parev. It's no longer kosher and able to be eaten with either meat or dairy meals. So now they've got a big problem with this, and they're having a run on chocolate chips at Trader Joe's.
Yeah, because they're trying to get all the old parev ones while they're still left. And they're all pretty much gone now. So, you know, if you're happy, okay, I don't think there's any Jewish people watching the show, but if there are, it's too late. They're gone. So,
yeah. Although I had kind of wondered about this one Jewish woman who's a wife of a rabbi, and she says, if I couldn't get the pareb, I'd have to resort to making something without chocolate. It limits your choices a lot. It says she goes through 5 to 7 bags of chocolate chips a week.
As a big rabbi.
You know, lady, it's a good thing you live in California, in Oakland, California, not New York City, because Mayor Bloomberg might tell you you're buying too many of those things.
Yeah, put a ban on, you know, limited, so like you have to, yeah. you'll have to show some ID, you know, like when you want to get decongestants. Like, I'm sorry, you bought too many.
Right. No more big gulps and no more bags of Trader Joe's chocolate chips for you, lady.
So this is my daughter, who the one who just graduated, was in the marching band. And anybody that reads my blog would know that. And they go to band camp once a year. Well, the camp that they go to, they rent out the space of a Jewish camp. Well, because it's a Jewish camp, it also uses the cooks are Jewish, and everything is kosher. And so, you know, whenever when she comes home, she's always craving cheeseburgers. And 'cause you can't get those there. you know, no meat, no beef and dairy in the same meal. Which, if anybody's wondering, it goes back to the passage is it Exodus?
Exodus. Yeah. It's do not boil a calf in its mother's milk.
Yeah. And so they take that as, I mean, it's a bit of a stretch, but as part of modern Orthodox Jewish living. That,
but you have to understand, the rule is, it's not necessarily, but it's the idea is that that you build a fence around the commandments so you can't break the law. That's the idea. So you're going to do this, not that it's necessarily wrong, but just in case. So we're going to build a fence around it. But
yeah. Which, you know, I mean, looking at that, as Christians, we go, yeah, you know, we break the law all the time. Because the first commandment is that is to love God with all your heart, and we don't do that.
But instead, we have to fight the war on the cookies. And by the way, until 1997, Orthodox Jews could not eat Oreos because they were made with lard, and so they'd always eat Hydrox instead. Because they were okay, they were kosher, but oh man, so they will find out. Well, it'd be interesting to see what happens with the company that makes it and see if they want to go ahead and change. Because it said, boy, these people are buying 40, 90, 100 bags at a time, and one Jewish school in Los Angeles raffled off 20 packets of kosher chocolate chips. So it's kosher gambling. Who knows? Who knew?
The thing is, you can get, I mean, there are alternatives. There's vegan chocolate chips out there that you can get at any grocery store. Well, any grocery store with the health food or vegan section, anyway.
Chocolate. We're not even going to go there.
I'm not talking about carob. I'm talking about vegan chocolate chips. The ironic thing is, because I've had them, I mean, I've bought them. We tried to go vegetarian for a while. It didn't really work out, but it's too expensive. The vegan chocolate chips actually have more fat, more saturated fat in them than regular chocolate chips. Forget this. I mean, like, they're worse for you on all counts.
You know, you talked about your daughter renting out a Jewish camp, and some churches, some schools in New York City to alleviate overcrowding have been renting out churches. Now, this is kind of interesting because a few months ago, the New York City, in my mind, you know, I don't know how they're going to justify this in court, and it's going to wind up going high up there somewhere along the line, but said that churches could not rent school buildings on the weekends when they're empty to worship. But they have been renting churches for some time in order to teach school. So they walk past crosses and stars of David and everything else.
Statues of Jesus, statues of Mary. Yeah.
There's the South Thessalonian Baptist Church in the Bronx, Mission of the Immaculate Virgin, Staten Island, Yeshiva Central Queens, and others rent to some 50 public schools. So some of them are, don't have religious functions. Some of them are like old Catholic schools that have closed down that are now being used. And this, by the way, is not unusual for them. To them, when I was in Springfield, the other ELCA church across the river from us, their building was being rented out by a kindergarten in Springfield because for the Springfield Public Schools for classroom stuff because they were overcrowded.
People like you are the reason I was afraid to go to school as a child.
And they approached us about an alternative high school in our building, but we didn't really have the room for it.
You know, it makes sense. North Ridgeville's struggling with overcrowding in our schools right now. The town's growing like crazy, and they, you know, they can't figure out what to do with all the students. They literally, when school opened this year, some students had to stand because they didn't have enough chairs and desks.
Put them out on the street.
So, but yeah, I mean, and I look at this and I go, okay, so they're meeting in like an old Catholic school. Yeah, there's, you know, Christian imagery on the outside, but none on the inside. You know, they've taken all the crosses and crucifixes and whatever else out of there. Okay. But you're still, you know, you're seeing the stuff as you walk in. Well, of course, you're seeing it as you drive by too. So it's not like, right. Oh, a cross. What's that? You know? But at the same time, the problem here is not the fact that they're using that space. All right. I don't see the only problem that I would see is, and because I don't know enough about Orthodox Judaism, whether they would have any issues using a Christian building. I don't know.
I wouldn't think so, as long as there's nothing being taught there. Oh, there's one woman. I think this is kind of funny. So her kids go to what used to be the Queen of Angels Catholic School in Queens, of all places. From the outside, from the inside, it looks like any other public school. Not a trace of its roots. Outside, there's a large cross and some smaller ones embedded into the exterior walls, and they look like little plus signs. They're Greek crosses. So probably not a whole lot there. But then this woman, this woman, Teresa Lamb, and she says, I'm Catholic, so maybe I'm just used to it. I can see how people would have an issue, especially in this area where there's people from so many other different cultures. I'd probably have an issue if there were Hebrew signs in my school.
Yeah, I saw it too. Hebrew is a culture and a language. It has nothing to do with religion per se. Star of David,
you'd have
maybe,
a
but that's not
because
Hebrew.
Because you can't read it. They're speaking in code.
Is you're anti-Semitic? No, just, you know, I think that when they get those quotes like that, when they're working on these stories, it's like, oh, we got to use one. This is great.
And
just throw a little ignorance in there. It's always nice. So, no, the big problem here is the inconsistency. Whereas you had churches that would come in on Sunday morning, they'd bring all their own stuff in. Some of them would use the chairs that were there, depending on the agreement that they had. They'd come in, they'd set up, they'd have their service, they'd clean up afterward, they'd leave, lock up on their way out and turn off the lights. And unless you showed up on Sunday morning there, you'd have no idea that they were ever there. So for the average kid, does this look like they're supporting it? No, they're renting out the space. All right. But here, not only is the school renting space from the churches, they're putting them in these buildings that clearly, you know, even if they've cleaned out the insides of them, the building looks like a religious building. I mean, there's no question about it. Think about when you drive by, a Catholic church, Catholic school, you know, whatever. I mean, these places look religious.
Right.
You know?
Let's see. P.S. 199, Maurice Fitzgerald, in the soon-to-close St. Raphael School, where a large religious mosaic commands the facade. The school is connected to a convent. PS 280. I just love the New York names here. They're so personal.
Mm-hmm.
Yay, go 199. No, I'm pushing for 150. No, I root for 280. I mean, boy, I mean,
see the
this
flags.
Is just...
We're number one. Oh wait, no, they're
or actually
one.
280. Anyhow, you know, so PS 280 has its name on industrial metal covering the old sign for Blessed Sacrament, but there is a Virgin sculpture of the Virgin Mary out front.
They just, you know, need to come up with a new name for the person and for the, you know, well, that's Eleanor Roosevelt, yeah.
it's just an interesting, it's an interesting, and this guy who's the head of the Alliance Defense Fund. Who's fighting because they've evicted these churches from these schools. And he's saying, look, I don't get it. You know, a church, the school district is weird and strange, contradictory. Schools meeting in former church schools is okay. Churches meeting in schools, not okay. I don't see the difference.
Mm-hmm. No, it's completely inconsistent. And, you know, that's this whole thing. It's be consistent, right? And, I mean... considering New York City is like the only place that kicks churches out that won't let churches. Oh, and here's the other thing, right? The school districts strapped for cash. Okay. So what are they doing? They're renting out these buildings. All right. They are paying churches. Whereas churches were offering to pay the schools money to use their space, to borrow their space, to rent. Okay. Like, maybe you wouldn't have such financial problems if, at least to some degree, you know, it would certainly help if you were renting out the space to people that wanted to give you money.
Couldn't hurt.
Just
by the way, you'll be glad to know the New York Civil Liberties Union is concerned about the environment at some of these schools. Yeah, they might have Hebrew signs. Well, let's go across the pond. Let's go to France.
Oh, yeah. This one was fascinating to me. It was a kind of a head scratcher. But at the same time, I think it says something about where we were at in the Western world.
Yes, the Reformed Church of France and the Evangelical Lutheran Church of France are merging into the United Protestant Church of France. So, you know...
I think they should just call it the Prussian Union, you know, for history's sake.
Yeah. You know, and they actually started talking in the 1960s, but Lutherans thought they might be absorbed. And so they failed, and they started a relaunch in 2001, and they just, you know, they really decided to merge in 2007, and now almost unanimously. Which, church leaders have stressed that the merger will not suffocate the legitimate diversity of their traditions. There's no desire for one to absorb the other, but to live together and become stronger.
They have two completely different teaching. All right, this totally reminds me of a situation. I may have told this story before, so if I did, everybody drink. All right. Right.
It's empty. He's already repeated himself.
All right. So when I was in Iowa, there was a the minister of one of the local churches. I was talking to her one day, and she said, I said, all right, your church is a merger of a Methodist church and a Presbyterian church. So you've got Arminians and Calvinists that are, I mean, the specific points that make them unique as a theology. That separates them from other Christian theologies are exact opposites, point for point. I said, so when someone comes to you with a doctrine question, how do you answer them? And she says, well, I answer them from the Bible. Okay, that doesn't help, right? Which interpretation of the Bible? I said, so just, you know, for example, if someone comes to you and says, where does faith come from? Is it something that God creates in us, or is it a human decision? And I said, how do you answer that question? Because depending how you answer it means you're siding with one side or the other. She says, I don't get those kind of questions. Right. My confirmation class asks deeper questions than that. I mean, so it's just like, oh.
So did you ask her the Mexico? What kind of questions did you get?
Yeah, I mean, it's just real sort of, I mean, it became very clear through other conversations with her that things were real sort of touchy-feely and not that, you know, feelings are a bad thing in church. I'm not such a stoic Lutheran that I think that feelings don't belong in church. But at the same time, when you sort of talk about, well, we just, you know, love people and, you know, and stuff, and you just sort of avoid the whole doctrine question altogether, not only do you lose your identity, you lose your message. Because if you have to present your message such that it doesn't offend either side, you have to walk such a fine line, and you have to throw away so much scripture. Because, you know, I mean, it's one thing to say, well, and she came from a Calvinist background, was my understanding, or at least she was Presbyterian. They would like, the church would go back and forth, and they'd bring in a Presbyterian pastor, and then the next they'd bring in a Methodist pastor after that one left, and so they go back and forth. But it's like, all right, be who you are and take a stand and say, look, you may not agree with me, but this is who I am, and this is what I believe, and this is how I'm going to teach, you know? But it's like, well, don't want to offend anybody. Well, you know what? Jesus offended people by telling him the truth.
Well, the issue comes down, you know, within many, you know, liberal denominations, they might as well merge because they don't believe in anything anyway.
Right.
You know, that's really what it comes down to. I mean, you know, I remember talking, you know, this young girl, and she was kind of part of an evangelical youth organization, and she called me and told me, I invited us to our church to some youth thing. And, yeah, so I talked to her, and I don't know how she got into the talk. She started telling me about, you know, she had been talking to this Methodist church, and, is United Methodist, and had talked to the pastor's son, and kind of, I don't think he knows Jesus at all. And then his father called me and got called back and asked for me directly, and he got all after me for, you know, sharing the gospel with his son. I'm like, yeah, I don't get it. I'm like, well, you wouldn't. You're evangelical. Like, you know, frankly, I mean, I've got more in common. You know, I when I went to Gordon Conwell, I mean, I was real, you know, I said that, you know, to a certain extent, I had more in common with some of them than I did with the ELCA.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, in a certain extent, I said, you know, if I want, at least I don't have to, you know, have a discussion with you as whether or not scripture is the word of God. Yeah, but what's it say that at the, you know, ELCA seminary in Philadelphia, you know, you can go there and you can be, say you'd be a Lutheran pastor, a Presbyterian pastor, a United Methodist pastor, or an Episcopalian pastor.
Yeah. This is a divinity school in Berkeley, of all places. No big surprise there. Same deal. And you can take classes right. From different, you know, backgrounds.
Right. But that's a divinity school, like Yale Divinity School. And that would be no problem. And Gordon Conwell, which is a multi-denominational seminary. But it advertises itself as such. Okay. Unlike Lutheran Theological Seminary. You know, you'd expect to just go there to learn Lutheran theology. So, but I remember when I was in, when I visited, Seminex in the 1980s, and the guy was telling me that a bunch of their people had been, you know, accepted into the United Methodist Church and their graduates. And I'm like, how did they get in the United Methodist Church? And the guy said, well, he says, you know, they go in and they talk to them and stuff. And they say, well, what do you think about the communion? He says, you know, this is where we are. Guess where I am and stuff. And then, well, that's not where we are, but that's a good place to be.
You know, and I guess the thing is, I can, when it comes to Lutherans especially, and maybe it's just my bias, but Lutherans are sacramental at their core. You know, in many ways, everything that we do in some way revolves around this whole concept of word and sacrament. And so to merge with a group that does not have, they're not sacramental at all. And it's just a completely different way of looking at scripture.
No, I'll tell you exactly what they're going to tell you. They will tell you that the two positions are not contradictory, they're complementary.
Which
that is the argument that they take.
And
that
that's
they complement one another, they don't contradict. Right. Well, when I was had a dialogue up here, now people should know that the ELCA many years ago put forth a full communion document with the Reformed churches, including the United Church of Christ. And so they have this, so you can be Reformed and be a pastor in ELCA. It is possible. So anyway, it's not a merger, but, you know, in a certain extent, it's going down the same road. But anyway, so I was in dialogue with the New England Synod Bishop. His name was George. I can't remember the last name now, but he told me that. I mean, I thought he was going to reach over and pat me on the head. I really had this feeling. I mean, being very condescending and, well, you know, Jim, you just have to understand. You know, it's not contradictory. It's complementary. You see, we emphasize Christ in the sacrament and they emphasize Christ in the community. It's just a different of emphases.
Yeah, except they also deny Christ in the sacrament.
And I looked at him and I said, well, you know, I see your point. But, you know, we've never denied that Christ is present in the community, and they've always denied that Christ is present in the sacrament.
Exactly.
And that hasn't changed. He was not happy. He was not happy with my answer at all.
I would love to hear. I know, you know, we've got a number of our ELCA friends that are watching this. I'd love to hear from you guys.
George, I'd like to get your comments. Dr. Dave down in Virginia, love to get your viewpoints too. Yeah, we're sound like we're beating up in your denomination. That's okay. 1 hour's too. Just, you know, we know we also got more than our share of warts out there. Mm-hmm. Hey, but let's go on this last story here. This is from clear back around Easter. I found this article and I thought it'd be fun to do tonight. But asking the question, does Easter celebrate a man, a savior, or a myth? Some say Jesus never existed and was a myth created by the early Christians. And it's an amulet. A guy saw a picture of an amulet depicting a naked man nailed to a cross. The man was born of a virgin, preached about being born again, had risen from the dead after crucifixion. But the name on the amulet wasn't Jesus. It was a pseudonym for Orisus Dionysius, a pagan god in ancient culture. He, based on that, came up with the argument of that Jesus never existed, but that the Jesus mystery was Jesus actually was a pagan god.
Yeah, and, you know, if you read the stuff on this, they'll talk about Mithraism that has a baptism and a something that looks sort of like the Lord's Supper, and except their baptism is you put somebody down in a pit and then you sacrifice a bull over the top of them and bleeds down on top of them. And, you know, I mean, there's some pretty significant differences. It's easy to take any two things and tie them together, right? But, you know, the real question is, okay, so there was this stuff, these other teachings that have some similarities, all right? And some of them have a lot of similarities. All right, we also have to understand, as of all people, Bart Ehrman points out, who's not really the sort of person you expect to be defending Christianity. The difference is, and the thing that you have to really note about these things is that first century Jews hated the pagans. I mean, it was just, they would never this wasn't sort of multiculturalism like we have today, right? The sort of you pick from, you know, you treat religion like a buffet and I'm going to have a little of this and a little of that. Uh-uh. All right. It was a completely different worldview, right? Because the pagan religions believed that the gods were beings that existed within the world, right? Whereas the Jews believed that God existed above the universe. And, I mean, it was just a completely different viewpoint of who is God. And I was listening to a sermon by, I think it was Tim Keller. Phenomenal. Now, he's Reformed, all right? But phenomenal preacher, especially if you really like apologetics and the real kind of, you know, kind of philosophy and stuff like that. He's real, real heady. It really makes you think. And,
I cut off, right?
Yeah, now you weren't muted.
Oh, does it set microphone off? Sorry, folks. I really did. I really hit the microphone off there. They also wasn't muted, so sorry.
Try to mute that. Anyway, he said that when you look at this, I think it was actually his Christmas sermon. He's talking about Emmanuel and what it means that God is with us. And his whole sermon was based on that one word. But the thing that he pointed out is that the clincher for the existence of Jesus and for Jesus being God is that his mother and his brothers worshipped him as God. Here's the guy that you grew up with, your big brother, all right? And you know him as a man, and no Jew would ever point to a man and say he is God. And yet, James and Jude, we know specifically of them as writers of the New Testament, who were Jesus' half-brothers, right? Sons of Mary and Joseph, that they referred to him as Lord, as God. They worshipped him as God. Right? And nobody would ever do that. I mean, that's why it was such a scandal. That's why the earliest Christian creed was simply Jesus Christ is Lord. That was enough. That was a huge scandal. And so, you know, to tie this guy and to say this guy is the God of the universe, the maker of heaven and earth, was just, I mean, ultimately, that's why Jesus was crucified. For making that claim. And, you know, so for these guys come along and go, oh, you know, they were just sort of dabbling in pagan stuff and mixing it with Jewish. No, no, no. They would never do that. So, I heard that and it was just, I went, wow. Yeah, I never thought about that before. It wasn't just that it was his, you know, that his brothers worshipped him as God, which is pretty amazing because, like, those of you with siblings out there, would you ever even consider worshipping them, right? But, you know, at the same time, you also have to remember their understanding of who God is. And he said, oh, yeah, he put it this way. What did he reveal to them after the resurrection? Because they didn't believe in him before the resurrection. What did he do? Such that whatever it was that they experienced, any possible explanation to try to explain what they just experienced, the one that seemed the most plausible was, my brother is God. I mean, you know, you think about that. Of all the, well, I had a weird dream, or, you know, whatever it was. No, they ruled everything else out.
Well, to me, it gets a little interesting reading through this and some of the things that they say, because they talk about So in the arguments, Paul never, the Apostle Paul never referred to historical Jesus. He didn't. He met all these people who saw the Lord resurrected. He said over 500 of them. He talked about Jesus being born of David, walking the earth bodily. Was crucified, resurrected. That's not a historical being.
Given that Paul's the guy that said, if Christ is not raised, we are to be pitied above all others.
He's
saying, if this ain't history, if this didn't happen, rest is all meaningless.
It's interesting because some people said, he talks about, he met James, the Lord's brother. Oh, well, all baptized Christians were called the Lord's brothers. Not the way James was.
He referred to him specifically that way.
Through and see where does it say Peter the Lord's brother or John the Lord's brother or Aloysius the Lord's brother? It's only James the Lord's brother. It's really weird. No credible sources outside the Bible say Jesus existed. They want to argue. Josephus was tampered by Christians, and Tatticus was in his stuff.
Tacitus.
His stuff was messed up with other people, but, I don't know. I just read through this stuff and it just, comes down to the very simple idea, Jesus existed. You can't get around it. There's as much evidence for Jesus' existence as anybody else, really.
More. Actually, if you start looking at how you determine whether a historical figure existed, And the the how much of their lives are true and how much isn't. You look at the things like when these events happened or when this person lived compared to the oldest manuscripts and documents that profess that attest to that fact. Right? And they point out that Julius Caesar, well, we know Caesar lived, even though there's a lot of myth that's sprung up around him and stuff like that. But here's the thing. There is so much evidence, textual evidence, they point out there's these extra biblical people. And what they always ignore is there's lots of extra-biblical sources referring to Jesus. It's just that a lot of those people were Christians, and they just automatically ignore that. Any references to Jesus made by the early Christians, well, that doesn't count, because they were biased. Well, the other people were biased against him. you have people like Irenaeus, right? Irenaeus? Who wrote so much of church history, what we know is based on the writings of Irenaeus. Okay? Irenaeus was a disciple of Polycarp. Polycarp was baptized by John the Apostle.
Right?
So, to have that close of a witness. And what it comes down to is all of these events, all this stuff that happened, all right, Paul, let's just take the example since they use Paul, right? If Jesus never existed, why was Paul trying to persecute his followers? He believed Jesus existed when he was persecuting the Christians. He knew that Jesus was a historical person. Otherwise, it would have been he wouldn't have had any reason to persecute the Christians.
No, he wouldn't have. There's no reason to be persecuting. They said there's uncanny parallels between pagan stories in the ancient world and the stories of Jesus. No, there is not. There is a world of difference between Zeus creating all of his little pagan, all of his little demigods running around the place, and God the Father and the conception of Christ Jesus by the Holy Spirit. If nothing else, there was no sexual relationship.
Mm-hmm.
It's completely different, but oh well. You're not going to convince these people. Even when you have people like John Dominic Crossan and Bart Ehrman who are sitting there going, these guys just are conspiracy theorists who want to sell books. I guess it takes one to know one.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I would know.
That's right. So anyway, did we have any emails or anything? This.
Yeah, I have this. This one's a little old. This is from back in April. But there was a couple points on here that I thought would be worth addressing. This is from Zandra on YouTube. She had a number of different things. One of the things she says, one more thing. There was a bunch of things that sort of a thread of stuff. But one thing she said in particular kind of jumped out at me. She said, since you mentioned in this episode the early church fathers, do you think you could ever somehow tackle the issue of infant baptism as far as if it were or were not really practiced in the early church? I heard just recently that it was, and I had never known that before. How can a person be a lifelong Lutheran and not know this? But here is one who did not. Good episode. Thanks, Mr. Show, and both of you. I'm glad you're back. Yes, it was practiced in the early church. First of all, we have what they call the Oikos formula, where it points out in the various New Testament accounts where it says, and such was baptized, and his entire household. Well, children would be part of the household, so then that means they were too. Also, if there are inscriptions on ancient Christian graves where we have, based on the dates, that we know that this was an infant or a very young child, and there are references to baptism on the graves.
Yes. There are also Polycarp, since you mentioned him, at his death. And Polycarp's death is fascinating if you read Eusebius. I don't know if it's true or not. I mean, what an old guy. He was brought before for this. Wasn't an emperor. Was kind of provincial official. And the guy said, all you have to do is say, away with the atheists, and we will keep you safe. Of course, the atheists were the Christians. So they didn't have idols. And so Nestorius Polycarp pointed to the crowd around him calling for his death and said, away with the atheists! But he was said, well, if you deny Christ, you will live. And he says, I have followed him for 80 years, and he has not yet once denied me. Am I going to deny him now? Well, okay, if he was baptized, you know, at any age, and he yet has been Christian for 80 years, he's got to be one old guy. So a lot of people say that's a good impression of the fact he just doesn't age. But there is also an argument from silence as well. There's two arguments I want to make. What is the argument from silence? And that is, if you do not baptize infants, you have to ask your next question. When do you baptize them?
Mm-hmm.
Never comes up in any church council.
Nope. Yeah.
So, I mean, now why? Why would they baptize infants? Well, how old were you when you were circumcised?
Yep, eight days old.
Now, my favorite is to look at Acts 10:11, where Peter and these guys want to baptize Cornelius, and they're just shocked that the Holy Spirit has been given, and they're speaking in tongues. And, you know, see, if you ask Peter and those guys about can an infant have a relationship with God and be part of the covenant people of God, they would go, well, yeah, I did. My son did. You know, all of us, we were circumcised at the eighth day. I get news for you. That means, you know, we were a week old. Okay. We were infants. If you ask them, so can a Gentile have a relationship with God? They would say, heck no. That's impossible.
Yeah.
And so
they were anti-non-Semitic.
That's right. I mean, you know, it is, you know, man, they were, yeah, if you were not part of the chosen people. So the weird part then for them is not that, an infant could be baptized, but that we could be baptized. That's what shocked him.
Right. Right. There's no shift anywhere in the history of the church where all of a sudden they started baptizing babies. You don't find that anywhere.
You know, the earliest liturgies we have are in the 3rd century. But then that makes sense because that's when the church was legal.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, of course, that's, you know, I mean, 4th century. So, you know, because Nicaea was in 325. However, what do they call it? Apostolic liturgies. And liturgy by its very nature is very conservative and does not change very much. I mean, I don't know if Dale in his modern service, you know, still uses the words, but if you, you know, use a proper liturgical service for communion, it's still meat, rite, and salutary. Now,
yeah, we don't use that terminology anymore.
What?
Yeah, we don't, not in that service.
I gave up trying to, you know, trying to change the terminology, but I mean, but still we use that type of terminology, the type of word. Well, why? Because it, by its very nature, it's very conservative. It's very conservative, very slow to change. So even if, you know, the earliest liturgies we have are from the fourth century, which, by the way, it says the children who cannot speak for themselves are baptized, you know, the infants are baptized. They understood it to be from the apostles. This was tradition handed down from the apostles. This is the apostolic liturgy.
Right.
So, if you want to ask more questions about that, email me privately. When I was in seminary, I did some research on infant baptism in the first four centuries of the church. So a lot of that stuff I just have, because I had a lot of trouble in, with that whole question of Alex, with should infants be baptized? So when I was in college, so I did some study on that whole area when I was in seminary. Fascinating area to study.
Yep.
So, Zandra. That's
yeah, right.
Which part of the name she's taking? So.
Right. Yeah, and I don't have anything else beyond that. So.
All right. God watch over you. Bless you all this week. Thanks for sticking with us.
And probably no episode next week. I'm not sure. So it's going to be a busy weekend for me, and so with the convention and everything, might need to set aside some time for my family. So
some people. All right. Talk to you later.
All right. Good night, everybody. God bless.